After going through this module, you will be able to know about facial reconstruction, about various types of identification and reconstruction, about various techniques of facial reconstruction and steps of facial reconstruction. Additionally, you will be also knowing the limitations of facial reconstruction. Amalgamation of artistry with forensic science, osteology, anatomy, and anthropology to recreate the face of an individual from its skeletal remains is known as forensic facial reconstruction. It is also known as forensic facial approximation. It recreates the individual's face from features of skull. It is used by anthropologists, forensic investigators, and archaeologists to help in portraying the historical faces and in the identification of victim of crime or in illustrating the features of fossil human ancestors. Two and three-dimensional approaches are available for facial reconstruction. In forensic science, it is one of the most controversial and subjective techniques. This method is successfully used in spite of this controversy. There are two types of methods of reconstruction which are used, that is two-dimensional reconstruction and three-dimensional reconstruction. Sketching of facial feature is involved in 2D reconstruction. This can be done by hand or by using a software. For rendering of soft tissues, the skull should be photographed with tissue depth markers attached. This 2D technique is economical, fast, and efficient. Minor adjustment in hair or face can be made rapidly and with ease. Skill of the artist, quality of original photograph, and completeness of skull are the major factor that affects this method. Whereas three-dimensional techniques are also used for facial reconstruction, which is expensive and time-consuming. Clay modeling and computer software can be used for facial reconstruction using three-dimensional techniques. In this method, the skull should be placed on a workable stand where tilting and turning of the skull is possible in all directions. The skull must be positioned in the Frankfurt horizontal position. Now, I'll be talking on the history of forensic facial reconstruction. Reproduction of facial features from cranial remains was first done by Weckler and His. According to the sources, His is acknowledged as the forerunner in advancing this technique. First data on facial tissue thickness was recorded by His. Later, additional data was collected and tables were compiled by Coleman and Buckley, which are still used in the present day facial reconstruction. Origination of facial reconstruction took place in two of the four major subfields of anthropology, that is biological anthropology and archaeology. It was used to reconstruct the appearance of early hominid form in biological anthropology, whereas validation of remains of historic figures was done in archaeology. Estimation of appearance of ancient people using paleoanthropological facial reconstruction was first attempted by Mikhail Gerasimov in 1964. Gerasimov techniques were later used by his students to help in criminal identification. Wilton M. Krogman, he popularized facial reconstruction in forensic field. In 1962, Krogman presented his method in detail in his book on facial reconstruction. This reconstruction, which was noted by Dr. Andrew Nelson of the University of Western Ontario, Department of Anthropology in 2004, which was known as Sulman Mummy Project. Then, I will be talking on the types of identification. There is basically two type of identification which are used in forensic anthropology. The first is circumstantial identification and the second is positive identification. First, we'll talk about the circumstantial identification. A biological profile of the set of skeletal remains collected is established when an individual fits the biological profile, then it is termed under circumstantial identification. Identity of a person cannot be proved with this technique as more than one person can have same biological profile. Whereas in case of positive identification, when particular and specific set of characteristics fit with individual's biological profile, then it is termed under positive identification. Correspondence of skeletal remains with dental records, medical records, post-mortem or antemortem records, DNA records or DNA analysis, etc. is also required. In criminal cases, when identification of remains cannot be done using other means, then facial reconstruction is used. Facial reconstruction, it provides with the strong leads that help in identification of remains. There is basically two approaches of facial reconstruction which is used during an investigation. The first is two-dimensional approach and the second is three-dimensional approach. First, I'll be talking about the two-dimensional reconstruction. On the basis of antemortem photograph and skull, two-dimensional facial reconstruction is done. Since many cranial structures are invisible, they are not ideal for use. Forensic anthropologist and artist both have to work together for obtaining successful results of this method. This method was developed by Karen T. Taylor in 1980s. According to his, at various anthropological landmarks on unidentified skull, tissue depth markers were adhered and then it was photographed. The lateral photographic prints are used as foundation for facial drawings done on the transparent vellum. There are two computer software which are used for facial reconstruction, that is FACE and CARES. They produce editable and manipulative 2D facial approximation rapidly. They also produce better images than hand-drawn artwork and they also help in speeding up the reconstruction process. Whereas in the three-dimensional reconstruction, there are basically two types: sculpture made from the modeling clay and other different materials and high-dimensional 3D computer images. The sculptures are made from the cast of cranial remains. Three-dimensional reconstruction also require a forensic anthropologist as well as an artist, similar to two-dimensional reconstruction. The manipulation of scanned photographs of unidentified remains, stock photograph of facial features and other reconstruction is carried out using computer programs. Reconstruction through these computer programs is very helpful in victim identification as it does not appear artificial. Next, you'll be knowing about the superimposition technique. This technique is one of the techniques that is included among methods of forensic facial reconstruction. For implementation of this technique, the investigator must have some knowledge about identity of the remains. Superimposition can be applied if the identity of skeletal remains is completely unknown, contrary to 2D and 3D reconstruction. An X-ray of skeletal remain is placed over the photograph of an individual suspected of belonging to the unidentified skeletal remains to carry out the forensic superimpositions. In case of a match, the alignment of the anatomical features of the face should be accurate. Next, you will be studying about the different techniques for creating facial reconstruction. Various methods and techniques are used while creating 3D facial reconstruction. Since a specific standard method has not been agreed worldwide, the method described is used after the assumption that sex, age, and race of the remains have already been determined through other forensic anthropological techniques. To carry out facial reconstruction, skull is the most valuable remain. Sometimes other remains available also prove to be valuable. Most of the time, the remains are covered with the remnants of soft tissue. By close observation of these tissue thickness of the tissues can be estimated approximately by a forensic artist. Estimation of tissue thickness is one of the most important and difficult aspect of reconstruction. Other physical evidences that found at the remains, such as glasses, jewelries, etc., are important in the final stage of reconstruction, as they can directly reflect the appearance of the individual whose remains are found. Next, you will be knowing about different steps of facial reconstruction. Most commonly, skull is found as remains which may or may not be covered with soft tissues. In case there is minimum or no soft tissue covering, thorough examination of the skull should be done by forensic artist. Identification of any bony pathologies, ruggedness of muscle attachment, unusual landmarks, wear of the occlusal surfaces, profile of the mandible, symmetry of the nasal bones, and dentition, they are the main features to be focused during examination. But examination is not limited to these features only. Appearance of a person's face is affected by these features. After complete examination, skull is cleaned and the broken or damaged area are repaired with wax. Wax is used to reattach the mandible on the basis of alignment of teeth. In case of absence of teeth, approximate vertical dimensions between mandible and maxilla are measured and then the mandible is reattached. Modeling clay is filled in nasal openings and artificial eyes are inserted into the orbits between superior and inferior orbital rims. After this, plaster cast of skull is made. According to the reference data, colored plastic or colored ends of safety matches are attached at 21 landmark areas after setting of cast. These landmarks represent the approximate thickness of facial tissue for persons of same age, sex, and race as that of remains. After all these steps, modeling clay is used to add all the features. The order which is followed while layering the facial muscle on the cast include temporalis, masseter, buccinator, occipitofrontals, and soft tissues of the neck. After reconstruction of these muscles, nose and lips are reconstructed. Width of the lips is almost as wide as interpupillary distance. Age, sex, occlusion, and race affect this distance significantly. Due to limited underlying bone, reconstruction of nose is the most difficult part of facial reconstruction. Width of nasal spine and nasal aperture is measured while constructing the nasal profile. To yield the approximate nose length, calculation is made of 3 times the length of the spine plus the depth of the tissue, marker number 5. Estimation of direction of nose spine determines the pitch of nose. A block of clay that is proper length is then placed on the nasal spine and the remaining nasal tissue is filled in using tissue markers 2 and 3 as a guide for the bridges of the nose. Below the bottom of the nasal aperture, LA is created. LA are made up of small egg-shaped balls of clays which are 5 mm in diameter. This is done after completion of the main part of the nose. Blending of LA with nose is done to give it a proper round shape. Next step is the addition of soft tissue around the eyes and facial muscle. During this stage, further measurements are made according to the race. After this, tissues are built up to within 1 mm of the tissue thickness markers and the ears are added. Reproduction of ears is highly complicated task. After completion of all these steps, clay is added till the tissue thickness markers are covered and any other specific detail is added. This is referred to as fleshing the face. Next, you will be knowing various limitations of facial reconstruction. Validity of facial approximation is not accepted by all researchers. Correlation between the bony feature of the skull and the soft tissue of the face remains weak. Variability of the facial muscle is high in both structure and presence, whereas some muscles do not attach to the skull directly. Rebuilding of muscles from hard tissue is difficult. Final appearance of face is greatly impacted by the subcutaneous fat in the face and there is no way to predict the level of this fat. Another issue with facial reconstruction is tissue depth. Average tissue depth is calculated according to the reference sample. Facial reconstruction, it helps in providing new leads that may lead to a tentative identification. Through dramatic representation of the past, they may also encourage interest in the archaeological material and promote additional research. There are several limitations which are associated with the forensic facial reconstruction. Some of the limitations include insufficient tissue thickness data. Sometimes, due to unavailability of some part of the bones, facial reconstruction is partially completed. For example, if mandible is missing, then facial reconstruction has to be done without mandible relating to partial reconstruction. The second limitation is lack of methodological standardization. The lack of methodological standardization in reconstruction of facial feature is also one of the problems. Recognition of a single and official method of facial reconstruction is required. This also presents major setbacks in facial approximation because facial features like the eyes, nose, and individual characteristics like hairstyle, the features most likely to be recalled by the witness, they lack a standard way of being reconstructed. The next limitation is subjectivity. Only the type of the face, the person can be revealed after reconstruction because of artistic subjectivity. Accuracy in position and general shape of the main facial feature can be observed as these features are mainly determined by the skull. So students, now let us see what we have covered in this module. amalgamation of artistry with forensic science, osteology, anatomy, and anthropology to recreate the face of an individual form, its skeletal remain, is known as forensic facial reconstruction. Reproduction of facial features from cranial remains was first done by Welker and his. Later, additional data was collected and tables were compiled by Coleman and Buckley, which are still used in the present-day facial reconstruction. Estimation of appearance of ancient people using paleoanthropological facial reconstruction was first attempted by Mikhail Gerasimov in 1964. There are two types of identification in forensic anthropology, that is circumstantial identification and positive identification. On the basis of antemortem photographs and skull, two-dimensional facial reconstruction is done. There are two types of 3D facial reconstruction, which include sculpture made from modeling clay and other different materials and high-dimensional 3D computer images. Manipulation of scanned photographs of unidentified remains, stock photographs of facial features and other reconstruction is carried out using computer programs in 3D reconstruction. An X-ray of skeletal remain is placed over the photograph of an individual suspect of belonging to the unidentified skeletal remains to carry out forensic superimposition. By close observation of the thickness of the soft tissue, it can be estimated approximately by forensic artist while 3D clay reconstruction. Identification of any bony pathologies, ruggedness of muscle attachment, unusual landmarks, wear of the occlusal surface, profile of the mandible, symmetry of the nasal bone, dentition are the main features to be focused during examination. Clay is added till the tissue thickness markers are covered and any other specific detail is then added. This is known as flashing the face. There are several limitations which are associated with forensic facial reconstruction. Some of the limitations are insufficient tissue thickness data, lack of methodological standardization, and subjectivity.